So it's my pleasure to introduce the next speaker, my colleague, Professor Thijs Vlucht. Thijs received his master's degree in chemical engineering at Eindhoven University of Technology in the Netherlands. Maya is coming from Eindhoven as well. In 2000, he obtained his PhD from University of Amsterdam, UvA. After postdoc in Mainz in Germany and Leiden University, he was appointed assistant professor first at Utrecht University, and then in 2007, he moved to Delft University of Technology, TU Delft, where you are here, first as associate professor and then later full professor and chair of the engineering thermodynamics. He has a number of awards and papers, more than 300 scientific publications, plenty citations and many grants. And please just visit his Google Scholar page. He's a thermodynamic professor here in our university. And when we have questions about thermodynamics, we go to his office. So Thijs, please, we are looking forward to hearing your talk about thermodynamics of hydrogen.
Oh, thank you very much, Hadi. So many thanks for having me. And I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present about my research. So my name is Thijs Vlucht. I'm a professor of engineering thermodynamics here in Delft. And if you have any questions regarding this presentation or so, then you can always send me an email and I'm happy to answer after my my holiday. Well, actually, today I'm on holiday, but I'm happy to make an exception for this excellent event. So I'm in the field of molecular simulation and molecular modeling. And what is very important in these kind of techniques is the time scale and the so-called length scale. So all the way in the lower left bottom, you have the quantum mechanics scale, where you look at electrons and atoms. And all the way in the top right corner, you have the scale of a plant or a unit operation, which can be meters or a kilometer, and the time scale is then typically a day or a month. And I'm in the lower left corner, molecular simulation and computational quantum mechanics. And it's a major challenge to bridge all these different scales, and finally to essentially design a plant from the quantum mechanics calculations. So why would you like to do molecular simulations, and why would you like to simulate molecules? Well, the nice thing is that from the interactions between atoms and molecules, you can actually predict properties of materials. And the tools that you have for this is molecular simulation, statistical thermodynamics, and theory. And the nice thing with these kind of simulation techniques is that it has some advantages. Like, for example, you can really make a prediction based on a computer model without having to synthesize your material first. Also, you can look at conditions that are difficult. For example, high temperature, high pressure is always difficult. Or materials that are toxic, if you want to know, for example, properties of nerve gases. And you also get more or less for free some molecular insight. So what are the molecules doing that is resulting in the certain behavior of your macroscopic system? And also, for some separation processes, there are many different choices available. And if you only want to rely on experimental data, then you have to synthesize the material before you can start an experiment. And if you want to do 5 experiments, that's fine. But if there is 5 million types of possible materials for your process, then computational screening can help quite a bit. Oh, there is a pointer. Okay, I'm usually not very good in pointers, but I will give it a try, and it works. Yeah, thank you. Much better. So, what these simulations need is so-called molecular models or force fields. And these models essentially describe the interactions between different molecules. So for example, here we have a hydrocarbon, and this hydrocarbon is consisting of CH3 and CH2 groups. This molecule has some internal degrees of freedom, and so it can have a bond bending, a bond stretching, and a torsion, a rotation around the middle CH2-CH2 bond. And from quantum mechanics, we can get most of these interactions inside the molecule. And this kind of model for a molecule, we then use this in a computer simulation in order to calculate thermodynamic properties. So there are essentially two kinds of family types of methods to perform these kind of simulations. There is molecular dynamics and there is Monte Carlo. So molecular dynamics, what you essentially do is you solve Newton's second law. So force equals mass times acceleration. And what you do is you essentially perform a simulation of your molecules. So you see the molecules move in your computer as a function of time. So essentially you get a movie of your moving molecules. And what you can get from this is all kind of properties. You can calculate transport properties, like for example diffusion coefficient or viscosity, but you can also calculate, for example, the structure in terms of the radial distribution function, or you can calculate the pressure, and so on. So molecular dynamics is simply solving Newton's second law. So Monte Carlo sampling, on the other hand, what you're doing is you're sampling relevant configurations according to a certain statistical weight. And the main difference with molecular dynamics is that the dimension time is not involved. So in molecular dynamics, you integrate your equations of motion as a function of time. In Monte Carlo, the dimension time is absent, and you can only calculate thermodynamic properties, like, for example, phase behavior, phase equilibria, adsorption, and also chemical reactions. So a typical, just to give you an idea of how a Monte Carlo simulation of interacting particles is going. So I have a so-called simulation box in which I have particles. And typically I have between 10,000 and a million particles. And the simulation box has periodic boundary conditions. And what I want to do in my canonical ensemble is to sample system states. So a system state is a realization of the system, and I want to sample them with a probability proportional to the so-called Boltzmann factor, in which U is the energy, KB is the Boltzmann factor, and T is the absolute temperature. So what you do is you select a particle at random, and you give this particle a random displacement. You calculate the energy change of the whole system, and then you either accept this new configuration or you reject this configuration based on the energy change and the random number. And if you accept, then you continue, and if you reject, you put the particle back at the original position, then you sample, and then you go back to step one, and then you do this a billion times on your computer. And if you do this then correctly, then you can calculate the properties for your system of interacting particles. And so this is essentially a simplified form. And why this works and why you have to do it like this, that is a little bit beyond the scope of this lecture. So what's also very important is adsorption properties. So for example, I have a porous material, and in this porous material I can store molecules. So the convenient, most convenient way to calculate, for example, adsorption would be to have my porous material in contact with the gas phase. In my gas phase, I measure the pressure, and I let the molecules move in a molecular dynamic simulation. And after some time, I record the pressure, and I count how many molecules I have in my pore. And then, in this way, I can construct my isotherm. So although in principle this works, it also does not work really well because I have a huge surface in my system, and properties at a surface are different from bulk properties. So if you do this, then you mostly measure surface adsorption. And also you need to wait for a really, really long time for your molecules to diffuse into the system. And this can be really, really slow. So what is then a more natural way of studying adsorption is to use a so-called grand canonical Monte Carlo. So what you do is you have a reservoir of interacting particles, and that is coupled to your actual porous system. And then besides particle displacements, you make attempt to exchange particles from and to the system. And if you do this in a correct way, then you can directly measure the adsorption equilibria, and then you don't have to bypass all these energy barriers. So there are two very standard books in this field. There's the Computer Simulation of Liquids book by Allen and Tildesley, and the book Understanding Molecular Simulation by Frankel and Smith. So if you want to know more about these techniques and how this works, then I can highly recommend you to read these books. And Bjørn Smith was my thesis, one of my thesis advisors, by the way. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about hydrogen. So hydrogen has a very high mass density, but a very low volume energy density, because the volume per mass, the energy per mass is quite high, but the energy per volume is quite low. So in order to solve this, you can consider compressing hydrogen to high pressures. And this is what you want, for example, in a fuel cell car. Well, conventional compression, using a conventional piston compressor of hydrogen, that can be quite problematic, because you have moving parts. You need a high pressure compressor, and the efficiency of these things are not very high. So there is an alternative, the so-called electrochemical hydrogen compressor, developed by Hyatt Hydrogen BV in Arnhem, and that uses essentially an electrochemical process to compress hydrogen. So this goes like this. So at an anode, I have a hydrogen gas, and at my anode, my hydrogen gas is converted into protons. And these protons diffuse into a Nafion membrane, and that this process is driven by an electric current between the anode and the cathode. And at the cathode, these protons, they recombine, they get an electron from the cathode, and they are forming hydrogen again. And the trick now to compress hydrogen is to limit the space for the molecules at the cathode side. So if you make the space here very, very small, and you increase your current, then more and more hydrogen will be here, and essentially you end up with high-pressure hydrogen at your cathode. And the advantage is that you don't have any moving parts, and the only limitation is the strength of your material. So you can nowadays go up to 1,200 bar to compress hydrogen in this way. Well, the only Hyatt Hydrogen BV, they have developed this to for refueling of a fuel cell car. So the only difficulty is that your protons in your electrochemical hydrogen compressor, they're moving inside a membrane, that is the green part, and this membrane is a Nafion membrane, and it contains water in order for the conductivity for the protons. So that means that my membrane is a little bit wet, but it also means that my protons are dragging a little bit of water into the high-pressure hydrogen side. So it is then safe to assume that the hydrogen that you get at the cathode side is saturated with water, and that is something that you don't want. And the reason for this is when you have your high-pressure hydrogen and you want to refuel your fuel cell car, you have to go from 800 bar to 400 bar, and due to this pressure drop, the Joule-Thomson effect kicks in. And so you all remember your CO2 fire extinguisher. And so if you use a CO2 fire extinguisher, then you will see that it becomes very, very cold, because the CO2 has to push away the air, and that causes needs work. And in order to compensate that, according to the first law of thermodynamics, your temperature drops. Well, for hydrogen, the Joule-Thomson coefficient is exactly the opposite of CO2. So if you let hydrogen go from 800 bar to 200 bar, it becomes warm. And that is not what you want. If you want to fuel your car, you don't want the hydrogen to end up at very, very high temperatures. So what you need to do is, before refueling, you need to deep cool your hydrogen. But if there's a little bit of water inside my hydrogen, then and I'm deep cooling my hydrogen, then this water might actually freeze, and then the nozzle of my tank opening will get a lot of ice, and then this is not safe. Yeah? So the problem is, you really don't want the water in your hydrogen. And the car manufacturers have set a limit of 5 ppm of water in hydrogen. Yeah, so if your hydrogen contains more than 5 ppm of water, you cannot use this for refueling applications. So then the question is, how much water is there in high-pressure hydrogen as a function of temperature and pressure? And is this more or less than 5 ppm? And if it's more than 5 ppm, how we can actually get it out? So we looked extensively in the literature for solubility data for the system hydrogen water, and it turns out that there was only a single experimental paper, and that was from 1927, so almost 100 years old. So there was simply, up till recently, no experimental data on the system at all. And as the pressure is quite high, this is a nice ideal system to do computer simulations, because you don't have to do then equilibrium thermodynamics measurements at very high pressures. So first of all, we looked at the different models for hydrogen interactions that we want to use in our computer simulations. And so what you then can calculate is at a given temperature, you can calculate the density of your hydrogen as a function of your pressure. And then you see that only the line is the experimental data from GraphProp, and the symbols are different interaction models or force fields for hydrogen molecules, and you see that the density you can predict more or less nicely. So at 200 bar and beyond, hydrogen is not an ideal gas, so you have to correct for this. So if you then calculate the Fugazi coefficient, which is the deviation from ideal gas behavior, then you can see that there's quite a big scatter. So the different molecular models of water, of hydrogen, they give quite a different Fugazi coefficient. So that means that you have to be careful with this. You have to choose the model for hydrogen that best fits this Fugazi coefficient. Now, the other properties that we then can calculate are the so-called expansivity. So that is 1 divided by the volume times the partial derivative of the volume with respect to temperature while keeping the pressure constant. The other property is the constant pressure heat capacity, which is the derivative of the enthalpy with respect to temperature while keeping the pressure constant. And then finally, the Joule-Thomson coefficient, that is the partial derivative of the temperature with respect to pressure while keeping the enthalpy constant. And you can write this as a function of the other two. So if you know the expansivity, the molar volume, and the constant pressure heat capacity, then you can calculate your Joule-Thomson coefficient. And as you can see, for the different water models, we nicely predict that our Joule-Thomson coefficient is indeed negative. So that means that if we let hydrogen go from 800 bar to 400 bar, then indeed hydrogen will heat up. But there is quite some difference between the molecular models for hydrogen, and none of them is really, really well describing it for all pressures. So that means that we also need better models for hydrogen. And so finally, what we did using advanced computer simulation techniques, we were able to calculate the mole fraction of water in the gas phase of high pressure hydrogen as a function of the pressure while keeping the temperature constant. And the symbols are our simulation data, and the lines, the dotted line is experimental data, and the solid line is essentially another kind of computer model that fits the data. And as you can see, the solubility of water in high pressure hydrogen is much more than 5 ppm. And so the mole fraction at 1000 bar is roughly 10 to the power minus 4 or a little bit higher. So at least way higher than 5 ppm. So that really means that we have a problem, and we need to get the hydrogen out of the hydrogen. Well, the funny situation is also that in your fuel cell car, you also have a Nafion membrane in your fuel cell, and that membrane needs water again. So in a Toyota Mirai, there's actually a water reservoir to humidify the hydrogen again. So what you're doing is you're first compressing your hydrogen, doing a lot of trouble to get the water out, then you put it in the tank of your fuel cell car, and then you put the water back in. And this is, of course, very inefficient, and there must be a better way of doing this. So we also finally looked at the effect of water on the Joule-Thomson coefficient of the hydrogen, and it turns out that if you have a lot of water, that's typically what you have at pressures of 100 or 200 bar, then the sign of your Joule-Thomson coefficient can even reverse. So instead of negative, as it should be, because of a little bit of water, it can actually become positive. So you really have to be careful with water in your hydrogen. Yeah, so what we finally did is look at the ice formation. So we looked at how does the solubility of water in compressed hydrogen changes as a function of pressure while following the melting line of ice. And there you can see in the top figure that still you have mole fractions of roughly 10 to the power minus 5. So that means you're way beyond the 5 ppm that is required. So finally, how to remove the hydrogen. So I have the water. I have my wet hydrogen, and I want to get rid of traces of water. And a very useful technique for getting rid of the water is to dry this with a zeolite. And zeolites are microporous materials with pores of the size of a typical molecule. And in these zeolites, I can load them with non-framework cations, so usually sodium or calcium. And water is very strongly attached to these cations, and hydrogen is not. So that means that the water is preferentially adsorbed from the zeolite, and what you end up is then hydrogen that is dry. So the problem is there are roughly 250 types of zeolites that have been synthesized in the lab so far, but the potential number of zeolites that you can synthesize is in the millions. So there are many, many kinds of zeolites available, and which one would be a good candidate for separating the water from the hydrogen? And you don't want to do experimental work on all these zeolites, so you want to use computer simulation to pre-screen and to select the most promising ones. And this is what we did. And then there are two parameters that are important. There is the so-called selectivity, because you want to selectively adsorb water and not lose hydrogen. And you also want high capacity. So per unit of volume of your zeolite, you want to adsorb, be able to process a high volume of hydrogen. And the parameter that you can play with is the so-called silicon-aluminum ratio in your framework. So the higher this the lower this ratio is, the more sodium cations I have in my framework and the more water I can absorb. So this is typically what you see. And so if you have no non-framework cations, then the selectivity is almost 1. And if you make your zeolite with a lot of cations, then your selectivity can be 50 or 100, or at least very, very high. Now, then you can make plots like you see here on the right-hand side. So here I plotted the volume of hydrogen that you can dry. The color indicates the selectivity, which you want to be high. And on the horizontal axis is the so-called void fraction of helium. So that tells me how open is your zeolite structure. And from these plots, you can then select the best zeolite, because you want a high selectivity and a high volume. So in this screening study, we were then able to go from 250 zeolites to 11 that potentially would perform well. And then it's up to experimental collaborators to test these 11 zeolites and see which ones are the good ones for this application. So we're also studying the electroosmotic drag itself. So we made a computer model of the Nafion membrane. And in this Nafion membrane, we have proton transport, and we can simulate the electric field. So then the proton is then dragged into the Nafion membrane, and then we can count how many water molecules are dragged along the proton transport in the membrane. And this is then the so-called electroosmotic drag coefficient. And we can compare this electroosmotic drag coefficient with experimental data, and then make predictions on how to improve these membranes. And finally, together with our collaborators at TU Eindhoven, we're also looking at zeolite topologies for the storage and release of hydrogen at low temperature. And so we can perform computational screening studies to predict which zeolites are actually good for storing a lot of hydrogen. Yeah, so we also are developing software tools. So together with David Dubbeldam, who is the main author of this tool, iRaspa, we developed a computer package to make these nice figures. Yeah, so you can really visualize your molecules and see what's going on the molecular scale. And this is very, very insightful, because your computer always gets a number Your simulation always gives a number as an output, but if you can put this into a nice picture where you really see what's happening on the molecular scale, that is really nice. We also, this software is freely available for download, so you can make these kind of pictures yourself. And we're also organizing workshops on how to use this software, and we typically have 200 participants per year. So for the simulations itself, we have made a tool called BRIC CFCMC. This you can also download for free, and then you can perform all these simulations yourself. And there are a large manual and a lot of examples. So if you're interested, then please try this out. So as some sort of summary, so what can we calculate from molecular simulation? Well, in molecular dynamics, we can calculate the transport properties like viscosity, diffusion, both Vick and Maxwell-Stefan. We can look at thermal conductivity, electric conductivity, but also thermodynamic properties like equation of state, VLE, surface tension, but potentially also a contact angle between the hydrogen bubble and the surface. Well, Monte Carlo, we don't have the dimension time, and that is more suitable for phase equilibria, equation of state, adsorption of absorption, and calculation of Joule-Thomson coefficients and heat capacities. So finally, I would like to thank my collaborators, Otto, Mahinder, Geza, Remco, and Mate. And, the list is a bit too long to mention all of them. And I, of course, would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer all your questions.
Thank you very much, Thijs. Questions, Catherine. Introduce yourself, please, also.
I'm Catherine Peters. I'm at Princeton University. I was fascinated by your Joule-Thomson coefficient results, and I just don't understand why hydrogen has a negative Joule-Thomson coefficient. And then one more thing is when you had water in with your hydrogen, was that Joule-Thomson coefficient a mixture value, or is it the Joule-Thomson coefficient for hydrogen when water is present?
Yeah, so this is the Joule-Thomson coefficient of your compressed hydrogen with water at saturation conditions. So that means the hydrogen plus the water.
Okay.
So it's a mixture.
But can you go back to why it's negative in the first place? A slide or two.
Yeah, so I think if you look at the equation, the Joule-Thomson coefficient is dT, dP at constant H, and you can write this as the HdP using the chain rule, and the HdP with a minus sign is then this. So T times dV dT at P minus V. So this one is apparently negative. So it is due to the deviation from ideal gas behavior.
So you compared it to CO2. Like if I had a fire extinguisher filled with hydrogen gas, and then
it would burn more.
It would get hot.
Yeah.
It's mind-boggling.
Yeah,
it's
and that is because of the equation of state, because this term is has an opposite side. And so for an ideal gas, this is really zero, and the Joule-Thomson effect is zero. But if you have interactions, then this is different.
Sounds a very good workout for me.
Thanks, Hadi. Well done. Oh, sorry. My name is Remco Groenenberg from TNO. So thank you for the presentation on the compression. Electrochemical compression is of course not new. I have always understood that the upscaling is a bit challenging. If you look at underground hydrogen storage, then we're looking at really high rates. For compression, high flow rates. What is the perspective of this electrochemical compression to be upscaled to hundreds of thousands of cubic meters per hour?
So I think the current stacks, they have the size of a container, and they can do 10 kilogram a day or so. So we're really far off from tons per day. Yeah, because you need very high membrane surface and the fluxes are relatively low. Yeah. So for really storing huge amounts of hydrogen underground, it's not feasible. And it will not be feasible in the future, I'm afraid.
Okay, clear. I was also wondering comparing the electricity use for this technology of compression versus, for instance, the piston compression.
Yeah, so the piston compression is a lot less efficient. So here the efficiency is close to 100%. Because you're only converting hydrogen into protons and vice versa.
Yeah.
And you may have some ohmic losses, but in the piston compressor you have much more losses.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a
lot. So I think it was a factor 2 roughly in compression costs.
It's been about 2 years I haven't seen this room this full, so it's very encouraging for us who teach in this classroom. Suzanne, please introduce yourself.
I'm Suzanne Hanks from Utrecht University. I wanted to continue a little bit on the Joule-Thomson effect. So I know it's really important for CO2 storage and the freezing that it can have in the wellbore. How much do you think it's going to be heating in the case of hydrogen when you extract it? So we're talking about, I don't know, maybe a 10-20 MPa pressure change at most?
Yeah, so if you look at pure hydrogen, where do I have it? Yeah, so the Joule-Thomson coefficient is minus 0.05 per bar. So if you have a pressure difference of 100 bar, this will be 5K.
Oh, that's nothing.
Yeah, but
100 bars is a lot, but 5 degrees is not.
Yeah. Yeah, but for a fuel cell application, you want to go from 800 till 200, and then it's 600 bar, and then it's suddenly 30 degrees.
Yeah.
And then you can get indeed freezing if you don't do anything.
Reiner, you had a question. You can ask a question.
No, that was only a statement. I think if you think about hydrogen in the subsurface, then we haven't this kind of differences of pressure. You know that it's tiny, and then the coefficient is tiny too. That means the influence is slightly neglectable. That was, yeah.
As it is also very sensitive to composition and mixture property as well. So then that should be also, it might behave differently in the subsurface when it starts to mix.
Yeah, exactly. Because what we in principle also could investigate, and that's something we didn't do, that if you have a mixture, if you have impurities in your hydrogen, and due to the temperature change, you can also get a phase transition in principle. Yeah, this is also what you see, for example, for CO2 in a flow loop. Yeah? That if you have huge pressure changes of your CO2, you can get phase transitions and all kinds of other things.
I learned from my good colleague Joachim Groß. I think it can be that you know him. He was here in Delft before.
I'm his successor.
Oh yeah, I know this. Joachim told me that the water is not the best friend to describe this kind of systems. Now we have salty water in our system, normally. How influenced the salt, dissolved salt in the water, the dissolution rate of the hydrogen in the salty water? Has this an influence, and how do you can quantify this?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it has an influence, but yeah. I have to look at that. Mm. And so together with Hadi and a few PG students, we're looking at the solubility of hydrogen in brine and what is the effect of temperature, salinity, and so on.
Will am I.
So that will, that is ongoing research.
As soon as possible.
Yeah, we will do our best.
More questions? I had one question in the online about properties of hydrogen when it is transported through porous structures and not just bulk properties. Where can we extend the molecular dynamics or really microscale modeling to quantify those type of transport phenomena for it?
So in principle, these kind of simulation techniques can be used to study the transport of hydrogen in porous system. So the limit is a little bit the scale of the system. And so if your pore becomes very, very large, you need a lot of molecules in your simulation, and then it becomes slow or impractical. So pores that are a few nanometers, that can be done.
Right, like shale formations, which are nanoscale pores. Very good. More questions? If not, one last. Of course, Leila, go ahead.
Thank you very much. It was really interesting for me. Maybe I can have one quick question about the impurity of hydrogen. You mentioned about the limitation of the 5 ppm of water in the fuel cell. I'm curious to know, because if we want to use hydrogen from underground storage, we would have also impurity with different gases as a cushion gas, like nitrogen and CO2 or methane. Do you see any limitation for this impurity, or is it's not even allowed to use any impure gas mixture?
Yeah, that's a very good good question. And to be honest, I don't know. But there are thick handbooks of ISO norms for specifications of hydrogen in order to use it in a fuel cell car. So there are, not only for water, but also for other impurities, there are limitations. Because some contaminations can really harm your fuel cell. And I think if you want to get your hydrogen from your underground storage to an application, yeah, you have to be careful with this. That's all I can say at the moment, sorry.
Marco is working on it for the mixing of it, so we will see how pure it will be. Thanks very much, Thijs. So once more. Excellent.